I want to say thanks, first of all, to Elaine and Jonathan and also Cole for inviting me. This is one of the most important conferences I've been to in a long time. In 2007, the WMD Commission, led by Hans Blitz, said the following: governments possessing nuclear weapons may act responsibly or recklessly. Governments may also change over time. As I recall, the Canberra Commission said something similar in the mid-1990s. And many or most of us here were very well aware that it was not a good thing to go on deftly assuming that there would be stability and rationality in the United States or any other country when it came to nuclear weapons. But here we are, and we have to deal with the situation we're in. So let me start out by underlining that international law is part of the law of the land in the United States under the Constitution and decisions of the Supreme Court. The Department of Defense acknowledges that military operations must comply with international law or conflict. So the question of how international law applies to first use of nuclear weapons is highly pertinent, or at least it should be. Another introductory and important point is this: the use of force of any kind is permitted under the UN Charter, a treaty of the United States, in only two circumstances: when directed or authorized by the Security Council, or in the exercise of individual or collective self-defense in response to an armed attack. It is worth stressing that Security Council resolutions regarding the North Korean situation contain no hint of an authorization of use of force. That's because China and Russia don't want them to have any such hint. On the contrary, they emphasize the primary of diplomacy backed by sanctions. Now, as to self-defense, since the George W. Bush administration, the United States has had a doctrine permitting preemptive attacks in self-defense against serious threats, particularly WMD-related threats. While the term is avoided, this is essentially a doctrine permitting preventive war. Under Article 51 of the UN Charter and international law, the extent to which preemptive attacks are permitted is controversial. At the most, the prevailing opinion is that they are legal when in response to the early stages of an armed attack by the enemy. Anything beyond that, in my view, is clearly an illegal preventive war. So let me turn to the question of the legality of international law first use of nuclear weapons. I begin with broad requirements of necessity and proportionality, applying particularly to the initiation of war, but also throughout its conduct. They are inherent in a rational and lawful approach to war, an approach that seeks to avoid conflict and, when it occurs, to limit its extent and to make the restoration of peace possible. The requirement of necessity, in a sense, speaks for itself. Military action must involve the application of the least amount of force required for purposes of self-defense. If a less destructive option is available for responding to an attack, it must be chosen. This has obvious implications for the choice between nuclear weapons and conventional weapons. Under the requirement of proportionality, the force employed in responding to an attack must not be excessive in relation to the scale of that attack. It must also be rationally related to the purposes of self-defense. When it comes to nuclear weapons, it is especially important that the risk of escalation is part of the proportionality calculus, as the International Court of Justice held in its 1996 advisory opinion. The implications are clear for first use of nuclear weapons against a nuclear armed enemy, as would be the case in a North Korea scenario. Now let's turn to particular military operations. There was a 2013 report on nuclear employment strategy submitted to Congress by the Secretary of Defense. I'm going to quote it at some length. The new guidance makes clear that all plans plans for use of nuclear weapons, all plans must also be consistent with the fundamental principles of the law of armed conflict. Accordingly, plans will, for example, apply the principles of distinction and proportionality and seek to minimize collateral damage to civilian populations and civilian objects. The United States will not intentionally target civilian populations or civilian objects. That's the end of the quote. Now, it's certainly to the good that the United States accepts that under the principle of distinction, civilians and civilian infrastructure may not be attacked. What is missing in this paragraph, however, is an acceptance of the prohibition of indiscriminate attacks. The essentials of that prohibition are well stated, very well stated, in the 2007 Joint Chiefs of Staff publication. I quote, attackers are required to only use those means and methods of attack that are discriminate in effect and can be controlled. So the omission of the prohibition of indiscriminate attacks in the 2013 guidance probably reflects the fact that it is extremely difficult, if not impossible, for nuclear weapons to be used in a way that is discriminate in effect and controlled. That consideration played a key role in the advisory opinion. The International Court of Justice stated that under the fundamental principle of distinction, states must never use, I'm quoting, never use weapons that are incapable of distinguishing between civilian and military targets. And the court went on to say that in view of the unique characteristics of nuclear weapons, their use seems scarcely reconcilable with respect for that requirement. Now, in addition to distinction, the 2013 Defense Department guidance also accepts the requirement of proportionality. This should be understood, a little bit confusing, but it should be understood as the requirement of proportionality in attack, as opposed to the general requirement of proportionality in the exercise of self-defense I discussed earlier. And you will have heard what I'm going to say in various discussions of U.S. military operations over the years. The requirement of proportionality in attack essentially requires that the collateral injury and damage caused by an attack not be disproportionate to the expected military damage. Now, because it involves the balancing of costs and benefits, the requirement of proportionality in attack, as such, may not be understood to rule out all possible uses of nuclear weapons. Imagine a situation when an enemy is believed to be on the verge of launching nuclear forces, and it is believed that only a preemptive nuclear attack can prevent or limit such a launch. Well, this scenario, I think, demonstrates, first of all, why nuclear armed states must avoid going to war. From a legal standpoint, it remains the case that even if a proportionality calculus is believed to justify use of nuclear weapons, it is unlawful under the prohibition of indiscriminate attacks. Now, let me just mention, in view of the time, other rules significant in this context. They are included in a preamble to the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons, just adopted at a UN conference in July. The preamble states that the states' parties to the treaty base themselves on rules of international humanitarian law, which is at the core of the law of armed conflict. In addition to the ones I've discussed, they include the rule on precautions in attack, the prohibition on the use of weapons of a nature to cause superfluous injury or unnecessary suffering, and the rules for the protection of the natural environment. The preamble also does the following, and these are phrases which have been very usefully used, very effectively used by the International Campaign for the Abolition of Nuclear Weapons, which has really been quite masterful in their advocacy. The preamble reaffirms that any use of nuclear weapons would also be abhorrent to the principles of humanity and the dictates of public conscience. I won't go into the details, but those are factors with legal value in international law. Just an aside on the Prohibition Treaty, it will enter into legal force when 50 states have ratified it probably in the next year or two. It will gain increasing authority as a statement of international law binding all states, including non-parties, which the United States is likely to remain, as its number of parties grows over the years. So let me conclude regarding use of nuclear weapons. The first use of nuclear weapons is at least generally contrary to international law. I say generally to acknowledge that skeptics love to trot out marginal scenarios where use arguably could be justified, as against a rogue nuclear armed submarine. First use is also irrational, regardless of the particularities of a given situation, because over years or decades, it would open the door to further uses in other situations and promote proliferation. The rules I have discussed also apply to the second use of nuclear weapons. And so most of this discussion also applies to the second or third or fourth use of nuclear weapons. Sometimes it is assumed that the doctrine of reprisal justifies the second use of nuclear weapons. But that is not as true as might first appear. But I don't really have time to go into that. So, regarding presidential first use, I support the approach of requiring congressional approval, both for engaging in war generally and for first use of nuclear weapons. And I suggest that the requirement of complying with international law, with treaties of the United States, be written into the legislation. Now, I was asked to say something as well about the potential for legal cases for presidential authority to use nuclear weapons. Clearly, Bruce Ackman right now is in a much better position to undertake that discussion. But I will say a few things about it. In 2003, Lawyers Committee on Nuclear Policy represented Congressman Dennis Kucinich and 30 other members of the House of Representatives in a challenge to the George W. Bush administration withdrawal from the anti-ballistic missile treaty. The claim, which was really quite solidly founded in law and history, was that Congress must, or at least the Senate, must approve withdrawal from such a treaty. The Federal District Court in Washington, D.C. dismissed the case on procedural grounds. The judge ruled that the House members lacked standing and the case presented political questions to be resolved by other branches of the government. As that case and many others demonstrate, the barriers indeed are steep to persuading a federal court to adjudicate large questions of national security and foreign policy. That is true whether a case is brought by members of Congress or by individual citizens. One possible circumstance would be where a majority of Congress as a whole has taken a position on a constitutional matter and the president has rejected the position. That path is suggested to some degree by the reasoning in the ABM treaty case and also a Supreme Court case, Goldwater v. Carter, involving termination of a mutual defense treaty with Taiwan. Of course, lawsuits can have significant educational value regardless of their prospects for ultimate success in the courts. So I'll leave the discussion of possible lawsuits there. I'd be happy to discuss further on the side or in the Q&A. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.